Hi, welcome back to the Block Show. I'm sitting here with Philip Castro, the CEO and founder of UTrust. Thank you very much for having us.
Thank you.
So you've just come off stage, and UTrust, that's a very exciting project, bringing cryptocurrency to the masses. Do you mind giving us a little bit of an intro into it?
Absolutely, absolutely. So what we aim to do at UTrust is to bring cryptocurrency payments to e-commerce merchants. So we want e-commerce merchants to start adopting cryptocurrencies as another, and in the future, as the main way of receiving and growing their revenue, and at the same time, since there's a lot of volatility in crypto markets, we want to protect and shield the merchants from receiving in cryptocurrencies by providing a just-in-time conversion and settle directly in fiat currency, in euros, in their bank account. So it's an easy way for you as a cryptocurrency user to spend your crypto assets and a safe way for the merchants to start accepting cryptocurrencies without much hassle, without the hassle of technical integrations. And it's just in an easy use, easy-to-use package, as you put it.
So in these two chairs today, we've talked a lot about how to actually bring cryptocurrencies to the masses. And UTrust seems to go a really great way of doing that, you know, actually allowing us to spend cryptocurrency on everyday products through your partners. So do you think that by providing this kind of window, providing this ease of use, do you think that is actually going to open it up more to the everyday consumer?
Yes, so I believe so. We believe that one of the missing, if not the key missing element for mass adoption of cryptocurrencies as a means of payment, besides the obvious regulatory aspects, is having a robust consumer protection mechanism that enables users to spend their assets or their payment currency in a safe way. Mm-hmm. If you think about PayPal and what PayPal brought to the table in terms of online payments is the ability to pay in a specific vendor and having a guarantee that you will have your goods mm-hmm. delivered to you or you get a refund. Mm-hmm. By their nature, many of the underpinning cryptocurrency blockchain technologies, they're one way. So they don't find any refundability for the users, mm-hmm. and for, in this case, for the merchants. That is something that we bring to the table, but that's only a small element. We think this link of trust, of being able to pay in an easy way, select the currency you want, to shield yourself from scams, from fraud, mm-hmm. and from the merchant side, from volatility, it's key to any solution. As I mentioned on stage, we believe this is more than just technology. It's more than just one chain or protocol that is geared towards payments. And it's more like an income-passing business case of how to really protect users using this underlying technology and make sense in this ecosystem.
I mean, it's actually not that long ago when paying online digitally, about 15, 20 years ago, that was kind of seen as a danger. And there was a lot of consumers who were very tepid about putting in their credentials in any kind of e-commerce website.
True.
And I think that's kind of the same thing we're now facing with cryptocurrency. And it's great to see someone actually tackling it.
Yeah.
So what would you say the biggest challenges are to onboard someone that, you know, may not have had any kind of dabbling with cryptocurrency? Because I'm presuming that you'd like to bring on all of us onto cryptocurrency.
Indeed. So the whole movement of cryptocurrency is a generational leap. Mm-hmm. So let's put the case forward of online payments. Online payments were also a generational leap. So if you think the older, born in like maybe 50s or 60s, this type of demography does not tend to use online payments even mm-hmm. a lot. They mm-hmm. still prefer the traditional way, but there was, with new technologies coming, with the internet, and with now mobile, there's been a shift. Mm-hmm. And now people are tech savvy. People use online, and in some cases, especially in Asian countries, online only.
Everything, so yeah.
Now what you see, like with a new generation coming, they are very keen on cryptocurrencies, not only as an investment, it started as mm-hmm. an investment. So say, you know what, I have some money, I can invest, this is newfangled technology, I want maybe to contribute to an exciting project. Mm-hmm. And you decide to join in, to join initially as an investment, but you suddenly realize this is bigger than that. This yes. is a new economy, a whole new economy. And now you yourself are part of this. So actually, the new generation is being born, or it's being already onboarded into this whole new crypto world. And yeah. for them, this is the de facto way of doing things. Sure, there'll be a progressive shift, but with more and more inclusive technologies, with better UX, better platforms, more regulation, we think there's this snowball effect, you know? And you think more and more there's a lot of interest in cryptocurrencies beyond just speculation.
Beyond
this is from the users
yeah.
and from the merchants as well. Mm-hmm. Merchants as well is very interesting. They think of cryptocurrencies as a way to tackle this new generation. So mm-hmm. they want to increase the revenue, but at the same time, they have to adapt to this generational leap. Mm-hmm. The way that this new generation uses online and mobile and all of this ecosystem is very different. They want instant gratification. They want things now. And you think about it, a bank transfer that takes 3 business days, that will not fly.
Yes.
That will simply not fly.
Yeah. Yeah.
So imagine they have been used to paying or tapping, maybe some tapping your smartphone with another mm-hmm. smartphone, and it's boom, it's magically transfer your value to another user that you want.
I mean, we live in an age where everything needs to be instant. It's
yep.
anything that's over 10, 20 minutes, we kind of lose our attention spans and patience
yeah.
with it.
Yeah.
Again, here in these two chairs, we've heard a lot of different views about the traditional financial world. Now, we've heard views that support that the traditional world will actually adapt to the cryptocurrency world. We've also heard sides that, you know, we're actually almost like in a civil war with them, locked in a battle where only one can win. But it sounds like you trust somewhere in between, kind of the emergence of both. Where would you say you're lying in that?
Yeah, that's a very interesting dichotomy, I would say. I don't think there's a civil war. I think we all need to collaborate to bring forth the potential of this new economy. So I don't see like one side just clashing to outlaw or doing everything in their power to make sure that this does not come to term. This, in any revolutionary technology, when the disruption happens, there's no amount of trying to deny it or putting the genie back in the
box.
True. It will happen. It's just inevitable in any kind of disruptive technology. So in one way, it's coming.
Mm-hmm.
So sure, there are different speeds. And that I would agree with the other side. There are different speeds of adoption. So maybe if you're an industry leader, maybe it doesn't fit in right now with your business model. But that doesn't mean you should not look into it, to the possibilities, to the future business cases. Mm-hmm. So there's that side as well. So I think all are going to be players in one side or the other. So I don't see it as a civil war, but more like a collaboration which has different speeds of adoption.
So there's a lot of, you know, you've mentioned yourself, you trust kind of being almost like the PayPal of the cryptocurrency. Do you think that moving forward, the financial institutions will be accepting of actually kind of like integrating with the bank accounts, becoming one unison kind of like offering? Or do you think that we will now begin moving like completely over to the cryptocurrency then and neglect our bank account entirely?
Well, I think bank accounts will still feel a need. Again, we're talking about a per generation thing. So legacy technologies tend to still exist for a long period of time, mm-hmm. and they will have their place in this new economy. So what I will think will happen is a merging of all the new technologies, a meshing. So eventually, yes, I see a future where maybe you don't need a bank account. Maybe the underlying mechanism, or there's an underlying bank that provides a bank account, but it's invisible to the mm-hmm. user. So I see a adaptation of current things that we take for granted right now, but under a new light. And of course, there's pioneers. And I think for some of us, for example, I would love not not to have such a legacy infrastructure. We can have like blazing fast transactions. But
that'd
again,
be nice.
Different speeds of adoption. Mm-hmm. But I see it as it has room for different players in the ecosystem. So, and again, different generations. So, for example, I don't see my dad using a cutting edge system like that. So, but then again, you have to think, will that user bring the future revenue and growth that those companies need?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe not. Again, different use cases for different companies at different speeds.
So do you see using cryptocurrency, like you used to work at the United Nations and now you're in this very fascinating kind of
yes.
new environment. Do you see cryptocurrency being specifically useful for certain nations or certain areas or just widely useful for everyday consumers?
Well, I see it in different facets, actually. So I see different use cases per industry. I see it in different nations as well. So I'm a strong believer that in the future, in 10 years, you will have state-issued cryptocurrencies from major economies. So,
interesting.
Yes, so I'm a strong believer of that.
That's quite a contentious view in this
yes.
community. Interesting, okay.
We could have a separate discussion on why I think that's the way we're heading, but to answer more clearly to your question, there are different use cases. So if you think about cryptocurrency, they're not really currencies.
Mm-hmm.
So they're encompassing different financial instruments. It can be securities, can be a payment token, can be just a utility token. Even inside cryptocurrencies, there tend to be more securities. There's a wide different range of different financial instruments with different mm-hmm. risk factors. There's also utility cases. So there's really a wide range of applications across industry, across country. So it's a lot. If you look at the spectrum of companies working in blockchain and cryptocurrency industry, there's everything. Like there's from mining, we can talk about the hardware and the mining
Definitely.
Aspects.
Yes.
We can talk about bringing new financial products to the table, payment industries. There's a lot of cases here.
So there's one thing that can't go when we're talking about payment through cryptocurrency, there's one thing that just can't be ignored, which is scalability.
Yeah.
The amount of transactions that go through, for example, traditional like Visa and MasterCard, it's something we've talked about for last couple of months, or if not even more.
Yeah.
How do you see blockchain kind of overcoming that barrier of scalability and then transaction values in a second?
Excellent question. So in terms of scalability, it's true. Right now, we have a bottleneck. So in existing standards, especially from Visa and MasterCard, they've been existing for a long time. So it's natural they can cope better in terms of transactions per second.
Mm-hmm.
But what I see in this space is the amount of tech and innovation that is propelling new protocols, layer two implementations. They're actually mitigating and adding a lot of value to existing solutions and new protocols that actually reinvent what we think about how a blockchain operates to bring it on par, if not surpass the existing incumbent networks.
I mean, the blockchain community and the crypto community are very strong compared to, you know, of course, there are other tech communities that are very passionate about their tech, but you see a certain kind of feel and certain kind of individuals joining this community and being very passionate about where it's going. What kind of expectations do you have moving forward? Let's say in the next 2 to 3 years, what's your kind of expectations of where cryptocurrency and using it in a daily life? Will we be completely using it at that point?
I think in some parts of the world, yes, completely. Yes. So what I see in the future, so this is my utopic vision in 5 to 6 years, maybe not to 2 to 3, but well, maybe 2 to 3, you never know. You imagine going to your local Starbucks and the payment experience, let's say you're quite young, you're mm-hmm. 20, 21. You go to the POS machine and you can pay and select a cryptocurrency to pay. You still use your card, but the primary use case will be to pay with digital assets.
Mm-hmm.
So right now, if you go to some parts of the world, again in Asia, It's very simple to pay at a Starbucks or like anywhere, just scanning a QR code. It's
true.
Okay.
Yes.
That is the kind of experience we want to emulate. And in those places, you completely bypass card. Like yeah, you can pay with card. The option is there, but there's not a lot of use.
Mm-hmm.
I see the same with cryptocurrencies. It's exact same. Ease of payment. But even before that, I see online as the first major use case. Why? Because it does not involve new infrastructure, new POS mm-hmm. terminals. POS and paying for physical goods on the spot, on the store, it's a good use case. But really the online one, paying for goods mm-hmm. and services online, it's the primary one. Because low cost of adoption, easy to use, and you can really benefit from all the technology aspects of blockchain.
Mm-hmm.
POS cases, we're still going for that, we're tackling that, but involves costs in terms of new terminals for the merchant itself. So it will take more time, So I think 2-3 years, yes, you will be able to pay online at major vendors. Offline, 5 years.
Very exciting, absolutely exciting. I mean, I can't wait to be able to just, as you said, walk into a Starbucks and choose cryptocurrency. That would make life a lot easier.
And you'll be surprised with the selection. Might not be Bitcoin. It might be.
So yeah, you're saying a little bit earlier before we actually went live here, you're saying a little bit about being agnostic to different chains.
Yes.
That is a commitment that, and it's a very strong and good commitment given that there's a lot of different projects and a lot of coins out there.
Yeah.
But would you be looking at accepting all coins or just the majority and the most utilized ones?
Well, it depends really on the market. We are very proactive on letting market dynamics decide which cryptocurrency or cryptocurrencies will be a liquid means of payment in the future. So we don't put ourselves in the position of dictating what the market wants. We'll let our merchant partners and our users deciding which one they want to pay with. So in terms of liquidity right now, sure, there's a large portion of payments going to Ethereum mm-hmm. and Bitcoin. As a percent basis. So those are the major use cases and mm-hmm. that's the ones we started with. But that might not be the case in the future. It might be actually with layer two implementations. We don't know the future, but we are putting ourselves in a position that for us, we let innovators bring out the awesome new developments in terms of chains that get a lot of transactional speed, layer two implementations, but for us, it's all about the payment experience mm-hmm. and bringing an easy to use mechanism for paying, making sure that you are using a trusted ecosystem, and as a merchant, you are getting the amount of money paid in your bank account.
I mean, it's fantastic. I think you've covered a lot of the most important points, which is putting trust back into the purchasing, using cryptocurrency for purchasing. Which is very important to give the users that sense that they can actually trust this payment system.
Exactly.
So one of the last things I'd like to ask, what is the one thing you're hoping to get out of Blockshow? What is the one thing that gets you most excited about the next day and a half that we got in front of us?
Well, always meeting exciting people. So I think these conferences are awesome because the people you can meet here. Sure, we got a lot of feedback from the community, a lot of emails, we meet a lot of partners, but it's really at Blockshow and other conferences that we really are able to shine and, talking face to face with some industry and like partners, mm-hmm. there's no replacement to that. And it's actually funny because I've met my co-founder, one of my co-founders, Nuno, at a cryptocurrency conference.
So, oh, wow.
If I would not join that one, this project, this venture would not have started. So this is a great opportunity for networking, and you never know what kind of opportunities you can get.
It's true. It's with the amount of attendees and influencers that are in these buildings here today, I mean, there's a whole new opportunity just waiting outside.
Absolutely.
Philip, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Really appreciate you joining us today.
Likewise.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
So I think